How is technology used in construction? I get asked all the time, what kind of technology do companies need and where can they get it? So I'll answer, what makes good tech work? What makes it go bad and not work and cost you a lot of money? And what are the three keys to having good technology in construction? So let's begin. Technology is crucial to the success of construction. I mean, even in our means and methods, it's just been an absolute game changer. We have equipment and cranes and pavers and surveying equipment that's just out of this world. That's typically the type of technology that's pretty generally accepted because you can't fake like surveying, you can't fake paving, and you can't fake hoisting, right? This technology has been amazing for the construction industry. It's really sped us up. And it has to be and has been really thoroughly tested. And so it served us well. Like I have zero doubt that when I go hop into a crane as a visitor, of course, and that those computer systems are running, that they're gonna run properly. I really don't have very much doubt about that. When we look at technology for demolition, for buildings with the 3D model, I really don't have any worry about that. Like that's pretty thoroughly tested. When we're out, we're using the robotic total station, not really worried. Like the proof is in the pudding, that technology is thoroughly tested. But there is technology that has not been thoroughly tested and that will hurt us if we're not careful. So that's what we're going to talk about now. Because I really want this technology to work for us. When we talk about robots, when we talk about processes, when we talk about specific tools, tech has been doing very well. It's only when we get into the realm of management, the things that human beings should do, where I'm starting to see quite a few problems. And that's when we're talking about project management. That's when we are talking about not having the basic fundamental skills for the technology, or when the tech is doing something that human beings should do. So let's get a little bit of a foundation and talk about some principles. Now I'm going to give you all 14 because I want you to have a mindset, but these 14 principles are from Jeffrey K. Liker's book called The Toyota Way. These are the 14 principles of the Toyota Way. One of them has to do with technology. So if you want to be lean, follow these steps. Let me give them to you one by one. Number one, always apply a long-term philosophy. Number two, create continuous flow. Number three, use pull and avoid overproduction. Number four, always go to the place of work and actually monitor where the work is being done in the field. Number five, build a lean culture. Number six, standardize your tasks. Number seven, use visual controls. Number eight, and this is the big one, only use tested technology, thoroughly tested technology. Number nine, grow your leaders to live a lean philosophy. Number 10, develop people and teams. Number 11, and respect your outside network. Number 12, observe and reflect. Number 13, decide slowly and act fast. Number 14, practice reflection all the time. Now, when you look at this list in construction, applying a long-term philosophy, continuous flow, pull, having the right culture, using visual systems, growing leaders, developing people and teams, observing and reflect, deciding slowly and implementing fast, all tie into principle number eight, which is only use thoroughly tested technology. And so this is key. We have to understand that we are not out there looking for the newer technologies that are all shiny, that are promising. If you want to invest in them, that's fine. But using them on the construction project, we only do it when it's thoroughly tested. We don't go get married and then meet each other. We meet each other and then we get married. So we need to make sure that we are thoroughly testing this tech. Okay. So principle number eight in the 14 principles of the Toyota Way, state this, I believe it, it's true, and you can find this pattern throughout all industries, all systems, and all environments. So you have to be able to thoroughly test tech and observe it. So how can you observe it? Well, let me tell you a story from my past. When I was first a rodman, I started learning AutoCAD so that I could become a field engineer. So I got the program, downloaded it, started teaching myself AutoCAD, started using it, and it was beautiful. Here's the pattern that I saw with this technology. It came out and it had a definite purpose. At first, it was a little bit difficult to use, and it was a little bit hard to implement because it wasn't synchronized and aligned with all of our other systems. Then it became easier and started to streamline. And then eventually it did more than a human draftsperson could do, meaning you can do more in AutoCAD and then Revit than a draftsperson can do by hand, by a long shot, by like times 10. I don't know what the exact numbers are, but it's huge, right? Yes, at the beginning, it was new. Yes, it was a little bit hard to learn. Yes, it didn't streamline. It was a little bit clunky at first, but then it started to streamline. And then yes, it started to 10x the user's ability to do their work. And so now you have the software, AutoCAD, Revit, that are just game changers for the industry. And you didn't lose anything because the same practices, the same standards, the same legends, the same symbols, the same best practices are being used in the software that were being used by hand. It's just that we've 10x that process. So it's doing things that humans shouldn't do so that humans can do what they need to do, which in the AutoCAD example is the design, the coordination, right? And the overall vision of the project. And so AutoCAD and Revit are now doing the line weights, the printing, the views, the automation, the synchronization, the parametric system, right? So it's enabling the user to have a better experience. That is the pattern that all technology should follow. And again, technology should do things that humans shouldn't so that humans can do more of what they should do. Here are some things that follow that pattern, which are great. Equipment technology, building information modeling, laser scanning and other VDC types of tech, layout, and also engineering and architectural technology that enabled them to do a better job more quickly and enabled them to iterate and model their designs and their final product. The bottom line is that technology works. Now here's a warning. When technology is attempting to do something that humans should be doing or is attempting to do something that humans don't know how to do and aren't trained for, or when technology is doing something the wrong way, that's when we're going to get in trouble. Types of technology that run into this problem are types that involve project management, scheduling, and some types of layout. I'll give you a for instance. Right now we have all kinds of technology companies popping up for Last Planner, for lean scheduling, for tax planning, for project management. And very few of them actually work because they're attempting to do the things that humans should do, number one. Number two, they do not provide the base human understanding of the tasks themselves and the computers doing it for them. So now we have a knowledge gap. And three, in most cases, the softwares are doing it the wrong way. And so when we test the software, this is what we do. Number one, is it doing it the right way according to time-honored, time-tested strategies? Number two, is the software enabling not only the use but the training of the users throughout so that there's never a loss of base knowledge? And three, is this software doing something that only a computer should do and humans shouldn't do? Like for instance, the other day I saw a new sticky note program where it would automatically fill out your stickies and do collaboration. I don't want that. Humans should be doing that. What I want the computer to do is actually analyze the data, the durations, the historical patterns, print it out, make it easily accessible so that it's frictionless for the people. I don't want it to do the foreman's job, right? So we have to analyze it according to these best practices. The other thing I'll rail on when it comes to stickies is that we've got all kinds of pull planning softwares, but it never ties those pull plans into the overall Last Planner system. So we're off track again. Or I see project management tools out there in the industry and they don't, not only do they not do it the right way, but they do it in a way where it actually hurts project teams. The software locks you into doing it a specific way, which eliminates past correct knowledge, and it forces workarounds that really waste the project team's time above and beyond what it would take them to just do it by hand in some cases. So we have a very serious problem. And the reason that I'm mentioning this in this video is that we have companies out there signing enterprise agreements with softwares that, again, are doing things that humans should be doing, and it's not in its place, doing things that actually reduce the knowledge of the builders and the users and doing things the wrong way, and we have to be careful. And so my challenge, in addition to asking you to please like and subscribe to this video, my challenge is to thoroughly vet your software. Thoroughly take your time to test it. We are all addicted to spending money for new shiny things. But at the end of the day, whatever software you use, whatever tech you use, it should be as useful as YouTube, as addictive as Facebook, and as quick as Wikipedia. And it should stay in its place, do things right, make things better, and enable the people that are using it to understand the fundamentals and to not just use it, but to know the basics of how the software works. And so I'm going to link you to a podcast on this topic that will really hopefully broaden your mind and your perspective so that you and your company don't get stuck with a situation where you're spending millions of dollars on something that actually slows you down instead of speeds you up. I hope you've enjoyed this video. On we go.